My name is George Moose, and I have the privilege of serving as the vice chair of the board of the United States Institute of Peace. And it's also my great pleasure to welcome all of you here this morning. We thank you all for joining us, both our participants and those who will be observing today's peace game. As you can see, we have a most impressive group of experts to help us game out some very tough questions surrounding the situation in Nigeria, and to explore how to counter violent extremism, not only in Nigeria, but worldwide. And we are looking forward to an active participation, a lively discussion involving each of the participants around the table. For those of you who may not know, the United States Institute of Peace is a congressionally created, independent, nonpartisan institution charged with increasing the nation's capacity to manage international conflict without violence. Our mission is to prevent, mitigate, and resolve violent conflicts around the world, and we do this by engaging directly in conflict zones and providing analysis, education, and resources to those who are working for peace. For USIP, the peace game is an extraordinary opportunity to advance our mission by thinking creatively about the nonviolent methods and means for resolving violent conflict. This year's theme, focusing on violent extremism, is particularly timely, I think we would all agree, given the current situation not only in Nigeria, but elsewhere around the world. It provides an opportunity for all of us to examine more intensely the drivers of extremism in Nigeria, the extent to which those are manifestations of trends that we see elsewhere around the world. The peace game will explore both the economic and the political drivers of radicalization and support for violent extremism. The overall discussion will use the scenarios of economic and political drivers to seek new ideas for countering and diffusing violent extremism worldwide. Now, this is the second of a six-part series. I had the privilege of participating in the original, the initial one last year on Syria, and I found it extraordinarily revealing. I can speak to the value of that exercise, not only in revealing the dynamics of violence, but also in enabling us to see more broadly the concepts and the possibilities for nonviolent solutions. Peace game is convened by Foreign Policy and the U.S. Institute of Peace. The support for this series has been generously provided by the United Arab Emirates as well, and we're grateful for their participation and their support. I would like to note and thank Foreign Policy in particular, and the person of David Rothkopf, for their partnership in this endeavor, and offer a special welcome to our representatives from the United Arab Emirates. Now, my pleasure to turn it over to partner David Rothkopf.
Thank you, George. Good morning. It's good to see you all. Those of you we saw at dinner last night, I'm glad the night did not take a big toll on you, on most of you anyway. Some of you look like it took a small toll on you. But we're glad to have you here and to embark on this next round of the peace game. For those of you who are not familiar with the peace game, the concept is that we wanted to take some of the tools, approaches, and techniques that are often used in approaching, planning for, and strategizing with regard to conflict and apply them to peacemaking and to keeping the peace. And one of those techniques is scenario exercise, and that's going to be the centerpiece of what we do here today. It's not a technical war game. We are going to use the narrative of the scenario really to coax out of you your perspectives on the situation with an eye towards the best possible outcome. We are not really interested in a 35,000-foot perspective on these issues. We are trying to find practical, paths towards better outcomes. So we also are not, you know, interested in enumerating ideals that are impossible to achieve, or in wallowing in problems that have been impossible to solve thus far, but rather to put our brains together about what might be possible to produce better outcomes. In this case, both in terms of economic and political scenarios in Nigeria, but also more broadly, as we discussed last night, in helping to develop a kind of a discipline, a kind of an understanding and an approach to tackling the issues of counter-extremism so that we might find commonalities between the various situations in which we encounter this problem, and perhaps common approaches, even as we recognize that each situation is different and requires approaches tailored to that situation. There are not many rules that you need to keep in mind as we go. One of them is that this conversation is on the record. So I caution you, there are people in the crowd who will probably tweet out what you say at precisely the moment you wish they didn't. You need to be aware of that. Secondly, don't fight the scenario. You may see the scenario as something where you may not agree with it or you may not think it's likely. That's fine. These scenarios are designed simply to provoke a conversation. They're not designed to predict the future. They're not designed to replicate reality down to the smallest, you know, increment. So go with that. The other rule is that, and this is something actually that Chris Shays brought up before, what we're looking to do here is to get into the minds of the various groups. So let us into your mind. Don't say, well, I would never say that in the presence of the Nigerian government, just because they're seated elsewhere at the table. Okay, you know, we want to see inside the minds because we think that'll help us get to that problem, get to the solutions that we're looking for. Finally, the last of the rules of this is that we're anti-speechification. We want to have a conversation. We'd like everybody to interact with each other. In fact, during the scenarios, there will be several small breaks where you will actually be able to talk to the other participants away from the microphone to say, well, what if we work together on this? Or is this an idea that your group would consider? So that conversational interaction is extremely useful. But when you speak into the microphone, and this is probably not the last time today I say it, when you speak into the microphone, touch the little red button in front of you so people can hear you. But when you do, keep it brief. The best way to practice this, to get to it, is to ask you all to introduce yourselves. And what I'd like you to do is to say who you are, what organization you're with, and what role you're playing. And if we can limit it at that, we will get into the concept of brief interventions. I have absolute faith that Johnny Carson can lead us in this regard with his own introduction, and then we will follow around in that direction.
Johnny Carson, Senior Advisor, USIP, a strategic analyst.
Yeah. Indeed.
Rebecca Patterson, National Defense University, World Bank.
Nick Kraft, just recently retired from the World Bank. I spent my last time in there. Was 3 years as country director of the World Bank, based in Kabul, representing the World Bank today.
Raymond Gilpin, I'm with the Africa Center for Strategic Studies at National Defense University. I'm playing the World Bank, AMF.
Christopher Shays, I served in Congress for 21 years and focused primarily on foreign affairs issues.
And you're playing the U.S. government.
With my partner, we are playing the U.S. government. Yeah, okay. I'm delighted to be there.
Patrick Harvey at CSIS at USG.
Teresa Whalen, the National Intelligence Officer for Africa and the National Intelligence Council, playing the U.N.
Chris Brown, Department of State, playing the UN as well.
Mohamed Abu Shahab, Director of Policy Planning at the UAE Ministry of Foreign Affairs, also playing the UN.
Michael Singh, I'm the Managing Director of the Washington Institute for Near East Policy, and I'm playing Northern Nigeria, along with my colleagues here.
John Payden, George Mason University, playing in Northern government and traditional leaders.
Martha Crenshaw, Center for International Security and Cooperation, Stanford University, also with my partners, Northern Nigerian Government and Cultural Leaders.
Mohammed Barkiro, George Mason University, also playing Northern Nigerian Government and Cultural Leader, and also coming from the Northeast, the theater of Boko Haram War in Nigeria, specifically from Adamawa State. Thank you.
Michelle Gergawi, Delma Institute, United Arab Emirates. I'm playing North African and Arab countries combating extremism.
Graham Bannerman, advisor of the USIP and the Middle East Institute. I'm also playing North African and Arab countries.
David Smock, USIP. I'm playing Nigerian NGO.
Pauline Baker, the Fund for Peace, and I'm playing Nigerian NGOs.
Haroon Ula, Department of State, and I'm playing Nigerian government with Steve Schwartz.
Steve Schwartz, in real life, I'm the director of the Nigeria office at the State Department, and now I'm playing the Nigerian government. So.
No doubt a dream come true.
I'm Michael Owen, formerly Ambassador to Sierra Leone, currently Director for Africa in the Bureau of Intelligence and Research, playing neighboring African countries.
I'm Chris Fomunyo with the National Democratic Institute, and I'm currently playing the neighboring African countries.
Bronwyn Bruton with the Atlantic Council, also playing the role of neighboring African countries.
I'm Sarah Prey with the Open Society Foundations, delighted to be playing multinational corporation.
Alberto Fernandez, Department of State, also with the multinational corporations.
Tawfiq Rahim, Executive Director of GlobeSite in Dubai, playing the media.
Clifford May, recovering journalist, including in Nigeria some 30 years ago, with the Foundation for Defense of Democracies, and playing media.
Kim Rattas, still a journalist, working for the BBC based in Washington, covering international affairs. And before that, I was based in Beirut, where I covered a lot of conflict.
Paul Lubeck, Associate Director of African Studies at Johns Hopkins SAIS, and I'm representing Nigerian business interests and industrialists from northern Nigeria.
I'm Deirdre LePin, Africa Center, University of Pennsylvania. I'm playing the role of local Nigerian business interests, and I've spent 18 years living in Nigeria.
Kate Omquist-Knopf, Director of the Africa Center for Strategic Studies at National Defense University, and I'm playing the role of international NGO.
Steve Feldstein, Bureau for Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor in the Department of State, also playing international NGOs.
I'm Princeton Lyman, a senior advisor at the USIP, and I'm representing today the European Union.
Peter Pham, director of the Africa Center at the Atlantic Council, and I'm playing Boko Haram today.
Amy Pate from the Star Consortium at the University of Maryland, also playing Boko Haram.
Leanne Erdberg from the Department of State, also playing Boko Haram.
John Campbell from the Council on Foreign Relations, playing Boko Haram.
Gary Ackerman, also from the START Consortium at the University of Maryland, also playing Boko Haram.
Nancy Walker, former Pentagon, now independent, playing African Union.
Thank you all. As you can see, we have a bit of a Boko Haram insurgency going on already here.
Taking over the room.
taking over the room. But, you know, one of the reasons we have little groups is that periodically between the moves you break into groups, and some of you may wish to talk among yourselves or reach out to other groups to talk about what might happen next in such a move. In the context of the scenarios, by the way, you know, I'm going to get up and walk around and pose some questions and try to coax this along in its way. I will never be able to sort of draw all of you in. So it is really, you know, your responsibility to intervene as you see fit when you have something to say that moves the scenario along. If the first person who raises their hand and then they say something like, you know, I don't like the way this scenario is going. There's a trap door under your chair. We will get to that in the conversations between the scenarios, but during the scenarios, let's just see what we can do to move the scenarios along. One of the things we want to do also is we would like to get the sense of the room. And as we get the sense of the room, I believe we have microphones, so we can sometimes get questions from folks up in the stands. But we also, does everybody in the stands have the little polling devices? Yeah. So before each session, we're going to ask just three questions. They'll appear on these big screens, which are just far enough away you won't be able to read them. But I'll read them out loud. And this will just give you a sense of the room. It allows everybody to participate, and there's no right or wrong answers. And the way these devices work is very simple. A question will come up. There'll be a couple of answers. You hit the button corresponding to the answer. 8 seconds later, it tallies it up. We know where the room stands. If somebody feels a very strong, compelling need to comment on the answer of the group, you may. Otherwise, we'll get on to the three questions, and then we'll get into the session that we are on to. So
let us go to the first set of questions that precede the economic round. You can't read them all, but it says here, what is the primary economic driver of extremism? 1, lack of access to education. 2, youth unemployment. 3, poverty. 4, income inequality. 5, inability to access natural resources like water or energy, or 6, other. We know that all of these contribute. The idea here is simply to get what do you think is the most important of the primary economic drivers of extremism. And we have here 50% of you say poverty, 25% say youth unemployment, and 25% of you have fallen into our trap, which is saying other. And I only say it's a trap because when you say other, I'm going to then say who said other, and you've got to say what you meant. So who said other? What did you mean?
Kind of social vulnerability of youth, I think, is the primary driver.
Okay, social vulnerability of youth. Good point. Anybody else? Something? Yes. Quip.
I'll get back to your question. Well, it was off the record last night. Ideology. If you're talking about some young person from London or from Minneapolis going to join the Islamic State, they may be going because they think they're part of a great effort to build the next caliphate, the caliphate of the 21st century. It is, in their view, a positive thing. They're not necessarily running away, they're running towards. And I think to ignore that is to ignore a very important part of what this is all about.
Terrific. Yes, ma'am.
I don't think I hit the button fast enough on income inequality, because it still says 0%. But because in this context with Boko Haram, it's such a Nigerian phenomenon, when you have some of the same economic aspects that are in the entire Sahel region and even into Chad and Cameroon, I think the Nigerian context of the perception of income inequality from the wealth is really an important part in here.
Okay, and it's important. You have 7 seconds. So you have to move for the button. Yes, Nick.
Within the context of income inequality, I would actually say exclusion. Exclusion.
You got to lean forward a little bit.
Exclusion is probably exclusion. The most important factor.
Anybody else? Yes.
Political or social marginalization, which should be differentiated from poverty, or because there are those who are well off who are also feel politically or socially marginalized.
For regional, tribal, other reasons. Yes, one more.
Yes, someone in my World Bank colleague. Economic inclusion.
Okay, economic inclusion. Okay, next question. Which of the following should be the top priority to combat extremism? This is on the economic side, obviously. Short-term job creation, structural economic reform, both are equally important. If you think you want to comment on this or add something to it, we can do that afterwards, but. Okay, so both are equally important. Although structural economic reform has the edge over short-term job creation.
Does anybody want to comment on this? Any? All right, we'll get to it in the round table. Oh, sorry, Nick.
I just want to say I think it's a myth that governments are capable of doing job creation. And so I think that's not a relevant issue.
So you think it's a myth that governments...
In the short term, can create good jobs in the short term.
By building roads, or...?
That's not short term.
Okay. then it's a definitional issue with regard to short term. Next. What is the most productive way the international community can confront the economic drivers of extremism on the economic side? Again, one, job training programs. Two, economic development projects led by international NGOs. Three, monetary support for local NGOs working in the region. Four, infrastructure projects. Five, micro-enterprise development. Or six, something else. Let's vote, then talk.
Okay.
So 40% say micro-enterprise development, 22% say infrastructure projects. Some of you said other. Who said other? All right, go to you and then go.
Referring specifically to the case of Nigeria, the country is far wealthy enough on its own. The marginal position of the international community is nothing compared to the political failure within.
So I differentiated my answer from micro-enterprise because I think small and medium-sized businesses are far more important, and I think entrepreneurship more broadly would be my other answer.
Okay. You wanted to say something earlier, Paul, so.
Just on other, if you're talking about youth unemployment, you have to deal with health and reproductive health and the enormous population explosion. The average woman has 7.4 children in the 12 Sharia states. 46% of girls between the ages of 14 and 19 are pregnant or have a child. You'd have to have an economic growth rate of 20% to absorb that. So there has to be, there has to be health, reproductive health, and raising the status of girls and women.
Okay. So the next thing we want to do is we're going to have a little roundtable discussion on this issue to kind of frame people's views and talk about what's on their mind. Paul's one of the people that was identified to speak on this, as was Pauline and Raymond and Nicholas. I want to pose a question here at the very outset that may not be one that any of you have specifically thought about, but it's just on my mind, and so I want to pose it first, and then we'll get into it. So any of the four kickoff speakers on this may want to jump in. But we've seen something rather extraordinary in the past couple of months in the price of oil. And it's not something that's in the scenarios or whatever, but the Nigerian government yesterday has changed the way it's benchmarking, the benchmark price. They've budgeted it down from 73 to 65, I think. It's clearly going to squeeze the government's budget. That's going to squeeze their ability to do a lot of what they do. Do you have a comment on how you think that is affecting this equation, and can it make the next 12 months be especially different from the past several years because of the squeeze on the government? Raymond, do you want to take a shot at it?
Yes. Countries like Nigeria are particularly hard hit by the drop in oil prices. In the Nigerian context, there are two important considerations when it comes to this drop in oil prices and its implications for the North. The first is that the Nigerian economic growth over the last 4 or 5 years has been anchored on a stable naira, which is connected to both international reserves and the strength of the sovereign wealth funds. Those have diminished precipitously over the last 6 months to the extent that we now have a new benchmark. What this means is that, not only have they diminished because of the falling oil prices, there's also been a capital outflow because of the end of quantitative easing over here. What this means is that the government is now in a position where its currency is severely weakened. A lot of the expenditures that it planned for both development and military uses are going to be a lot more expensive. And the fiscal space it once had to intervene more meaningfully in things like small and medium scale investment, infrastructure, the window has also closed on that. So the capacity of the government to do a lot of things it was able to do, say, last year, you know, is gone in that context. And this means that if we're thinking infrastructure, we're thinking entrepreneurship, et cetera, yes, Nigeria is rich, but from a fiscal perspective, they are severely weakened. And this is where both the international community and multinational corporations should come together in a more meaningful way to support Nigeria.
Okay. Let's go. Okay, Pauline, do you want to jump in?
Yes, there's another facet to this, I think, that would feed to the scenario, and that is that there's talk now in Nigeria as a response to this that they're going to end the oil subsidies. This is a very explosive issue in Nigeria. The only time that you've ever had a kind of Occupy moment where people came out across ethnic and religious lines to band together in opposition to the government was when they tried to do this 2 years ago. They were pushed back and they cut it only in half. This is now going to provide the government the justification for ending the oil subsidies. This will hit the north extremely hard. That's the heart of the poverty area. And it could come at a time where things are heating up because of the election. So it is a very explosive thing, and it could generate a new dynamic in Nigeria because of the confluence of these things coming together.
Is it fair to say then, based on both sets of comments, that the issues that drive extremism, division, and tension in Nigeria are almost certain to get worse over the course of the next year?
I think so. And as a result of the lowering of the oil price, which also is going to hamper the ability of the current government to finance the election, support patronage, etc. It's going to enhance the opportunities of the opposition to appeal to the grievances that exist not only in the north but throughout the country based on the oil price.
Okay, so in the context of our scenario, what we're trying to do is we want to look at the economic roots of extremism with an idea towards how do we address them? How do we counteract the factors that lead people towards extremism in that context? And that's where I'd like to direct the next round of questions for this group. And then I'd like to open the discussion to everybody. But let me turn to you, Nick. You know, what do you see as the core economic roots of extremism in this case? And what's your outlook for the factors that are driving those things over the course of the next 12 months, say?
Just to go back to a comment I made earlier, I think that the issue of exclusion and lack of perceived social justice remain at the core of what's going on here. What I think you have in Nigeria and in many other states is essentially a predatory government, or as seen by the population. This is a government that's more interested in fostering wealth and capturing the rents from the oil revenue at the exclusion of the poorer people. So I think unless you can address the issues of governance, good governance, and reduce the predatory behavior, I mean, clearly having more money means you can spread some level of wealth to the poor, but doesn't really address the basic issue, in my opinion. I mean, just to give a very specific example in Afghanistan, with which I'm much more familiar, one talks about, you know, Karzai's half-brother, AWK, who was always supported by the donor group. But in fact, what you had, you know, you had a leader who donors, national governments liked to talk to. They sort of kind of understood him. But he controlled an area in which people did not feel secure. If you belonged to an ethnic group and you misbehaved, you could have your land taken away. You could have your jobs taken away. It could be played out like this. And this basic insecurity that you have through poor governance, is, I think, at the core of what's doing this. So putting in more projects was one of the things on, I don't think necessarily helps. I think you've really got to get in and tackle the issues of governance. And I think in Nigeria, it's critically important. Price of oil, clearly, more oil, you can spread some wealth, but you've really got to address the
now,
issue.
Let me ask you a question. In the context of what we're trying to talk about, which is best possible outcomes,
right,
where there may be structural impediments and cultural impediments and personal impediments to doing that at the national level, if you value governance in that way, does that then mean by extension that you think it needs to be done at the state and local level, at some level providing this? Do you follow my question?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think one has to do it at all levels. I mean, I think it's really important to enhance the voice of civil society so that you have some level of opposition through civil society where people can feel that their views are expressed, as opposed to feeling they're excluded, their voices are never heard. So I think you have to work at that level, but I think you also have to work at the levels of government and so on. So I think one of the things that's really important is developing good public financial management systems throughout the government. it's not easy because when donors, and here I would say very often the United States, and I'm thinking about Afghanistan, lends its heavy hand and says, you will do this and you will do that, immediately everyone reacts, the entire population. So it's very difficult to build up the governance side. But I think of your list of things that you had there before, projects and whatever, I think the thing that was most lacking there was this issue of governance.
Okay. Paul, same question. As you look at the economic drivers of extremism in the context of Nigeria, the context more broadly, how are things, you know, what's most important, what's likely to change over the next few months? I said, as you look at the economic drivers of extremism that you think are most important, how do you prioritize them? What, you know, which of those are most important to you? And looking forward, how are those likely to change?
Yeah, in terms of the economic drivers, the push factor here is an enormous demographic crisis where some enormous proportion of the population is going to be under 25. The fertility rate I just described means that every 14 years there'll be waves of young men coming into cities. Urbanization is increasing. So that has to be taken into account when you look at employment opportunities. So the problem is to try to get as much labor absorption into existing industries. There needs to be an emphasis on agro-industrial linkages and the revival of agro-industrial linkages like cotton for the textile industry, food processing, especially meat. Meat, price of meat grows about 8%, controlling for inflation in southern Nigeria. It has great opportunities there, and this needs to be organized. States need to create regional development agencies to work with private investors to increase investment, presuming that security can be reestablished.
Okay, same question to you, Pauline.
I think the emphasis on labor is important, but I agree that it's the structural issues have to be addressed and inclusion. And I think there are new governance mechanisms that have to be created that do allow the expression of the frustrations on the ground. To your question as to whether or not it should be done at the state or the federal level, I think that it has to be done at both levels. At the local government level, the capacity just isn't there yet. There are states and there are institutions in Nigeria that are in a position of having credibility with people who are frustrated at the lower levels. And I don't think these institutions and state mechanisms are being used enough. Some of them are traditional leaders. Some of them are some governors who have governed fairly well. Some of them are civil society institutions. I think we have to think a little bit more creatively and, in a sense, pick and choose those candidates through whom the investment would be well managed. I think that's an issue. The corruption issue is part of the exclusion issue, the perception that where there is wealth in Nigeria, it's stolen. So it's got to be a kind of a coalition to create economic opportunity. There have been so many master plans and so forth that nothing has happened. It all gets back to governance. But we can't just go through the existing institutions because they lack legitimacy.
Okay, this gets to a really critical point here. And I want to, you know, frame this in a way that it guides us during the course of the day. There are prescriptions for fixing countries in this kind of situation that are undeniably correct on the economic basis or their political basis, but which take long, long periods of time and require kinds of leadership and kinds of governance and kinds of international cooperation that may not exist. Fundamental structural change happens slowly. Extremism happens fast. The issues that we want to discuss here today are what things can actually happen through mechanisms that actually exist that can make a difference fast enough to counteract the spread of extremism. So we have to wean ourselves away from ideals or best cases and work down on the ground of reality. Now I want to open this to the rest of the group in a moment, but I want to just one last question to Raymond, which is, in that context, what do you think is there that could work now?
I think it's a really difficult and complex issue. The nature of extremism in northern Nigeria is really entrenched, has a long history, but you're looking for quick fixes. I think you do have a few leaders that are emerging. For example, the new emir of Kano. He is embraced, not just by his peers, but also by young people who see him as a champion, an anti-corruption champion, because he was formerly the governor of the central bank, and he fell out with Abuja because he unearthed major corruption scandals, using him as an interlocutor and putting people to work, and also re-energizing the economy. Perception goes a long way up north. If people believe that things are moving in the right direction, you would see a lot of the small and medium scale businesses coming back. You'd also see distancing between the communities and the extremists. But at the moment, there is no trust between the communities and a lot of the folk at the state level. Another issue related to the drop in oil prices is that the oil sharing formula is what funds the administrations up north. And with a drop in oil prices, there'll be a drop in receipts by the by the state governments. But what we also need to do is build on a lot of work that has been done in expanding the tax base up north. And I think using leaders like ex-Governor Sanusi, who is now the Emir of Kano, is critical.
Go ahead.
Johnny, I know you had your hand up a little earlier, and I know you spent a lot of time thinking about working with the governors. And we've hosted a couple of events here. And I wanted to, just following on David's question to Raymond, what do you see in those state leaderships that might offer some possibility, some promise of short-term responses to the situation?
The governors in northern Nigeria are a mixed bag. Some of them represent reform and progressive thinking. I'm thinking of the governor of Kano, who has done a lot to model himself after the successful governor in Lagos. And he is regarded as someone who is close to the people and who has the interest of the people. There are other governors who have been linked to corruption and misuse of state funds. And there are some who have been alleged to have had ties with some elements of radical fringes in the north. So they are, in fact, a mixed bag. I think that it is important not only to identify governors that you can work with, but it is equally important to identify projects that have a direct impact on improving the lives of people, demonstrating that there is an opportunity out of the morass and economic and social immiseration that they have been suffering from.
Okay. You know, what's useful to us in these last couple of comments is a particular focus on individuals who might work, because we are looking for what might work. Go ahead, Princeton.
It seems to me that the decline in the oil prices is going to exacerbate the regional rivalries in Nigeria between the Southeast, which is always demanding more because it's the oil-producing area, and the others. And I think it's going to produce a much more intense and violent electoral system coming up. But out of crisis comes opportunity, because it does, it seems to me, offer the opportunity in Nigeria to say, wait a minute, we can't keep going on the way we are. We don't have enough resources to keep playing this game, and things are getting worse. And that's where it seems to me the international community can play a very important role, to provide forums, to provide opportunities through IMF, World Bank, other international structures to say, look, there are ways to deal with this crisis, and with the leadership in Nigeria coming together, there are ways to solve a number of these problems. And there are people in Nigeria, there are governors, there are business people, there are others who understand exactly what needs to be done. And as we move toward what I think is going to be an increasingly crisis situation in Nigeria over the next 6 months, 4 months, that we reach out and open doors for that kind of thinking, informal forums and then formal ones that say there's a way out of this crisis and will encourage the Nigerians to come together around it. And I think that opportunity may exist.
Okay, and I saw Nick first, and then I'll come back down there, yeah.
I just wanted to make two very quick points. One is, I think the issue of governance and corruption is really paramount, but you cannot tackle it unless the leadership is itself interested in that. And that, I think, is one of the lessons I learned from Afghanistan, that if the president or the senior leaders are really not interested in tackling major issues of corruption, you will have no success as a donor body. So I really support Raymond's view that if you can find people who through whom you can work, that is, the leadership is really essential. That doesn't mean if you don't find those, you can do nothing, because there are lots of things you can do to build inclusion, education projects, health projects, and so on, which can function very effectively. So I would say you need to do both together. But if you're not going to get the leadership, you're not going to be able to tackle governance and legal reform in a meaningful way.
Okay.
I just wanted to say it seemed that we were going down too far a path on this, the role of economic determinism in this issue. I mean, I hear words like trust, keywords like trust, like leadership, like the state, like forums. These are not inherently economic concerns. I think that there's the economic role, there's the economic roots, but there's something else. You know, why are countries like Niger and Chad, which have, you know, large populations, poverty, corruption, etc., why do they not have problems of violent extremism? So I'm a little leery when I hear about large families and fertility and micro enterprises, that we're going too far down that path of, you know, if we get the economic stars alight, the problem will be solved.
Okay, that's a good point, but I do want to say this is the economic part of the discussion. So this is when we talk about that. And as we said last night,
ideology, social issues, political issues, leadership issues, economic issues, security issues, all play a role in this. So it's not so much economic determinism as it is the agenda. But I get your point. Yes, Kate.
Well, perhaps building on Alberto's point for a moment, the socioeconomic conditions we're talking about are not unique. They're not just in northern Nigeria. So there's something else going on as to why there is this tremendous extremism problem there. And I think it goes back to one of the comments Princeton made last night on states, so the weakness of the state and institutions. And to Raymond's point about building trust, we know from research and empirical evidence on how recurring cycles of violence end that restoring confidence in the state is of utmost importance. So if we're talking about economic development projects and activities, we have to think about how to do them in a way that restores legitimacy, restores confidence in the state and in local actors. And part of that is Raymond's point on borrowing legitimacy from other institutions or actors that do have it, and trying to get state, whether local government leaders or national government leaders, to work with those institutions that are seen legitimate, whether delivering services or trying to address some of the underlying economic issues.
I think these are very important points. I do want to say, you know, that very often you encounter extremism in places that are failed states or failing states where you actually don't have these ideal conditions. And the question is, how do you counter that extremism in those places when a condition of the situation is that you don't have the effective governance and that you do have the institutions not working? And so one of the things we're looking at here is, are there other tools, things you can use? It's not going to solve the problem. Might it impede the speed of the spread of the problem? Might it impede the degree of the problem? That's another way that we can get to the best possible outcome. Leanne, then I'll come to you.
One of the things that I think in the economic discussion is incredibly important is the perception of the economic gain. So it's not necessarily that you have to go from zero to ideal, but there has to be some sort of perception of increase. And so one of the things that we, you know, could think about in terms of a central government like Abuja is trying to help diversify what the economic incentives are to work in really difficult places, whether it's tax breaks or loan rates or things along those lines. There's a reason why the Lagos-Ibadan corridor is so attractive for investment. It's because everything is already working there. But if nothing is working up north and all of the tax rates and all of the loan rates and every way in which you borrow is the exact same, why would you invest up north if you're Aliko Dangote or someone else in this field? And this is a really important governance qua, you know, economic development question, which is how do you incentivize getting that economic development so people have a perception that things are changing? And a quick anecdote on that is Governor Michi down in Port Harcourt trying to get a monorail. They don't need a monorail in Port Harcourt per se, but the perception that Port Harcourt could have a monorail has a huge, you know, perception impact of the people down there. Like, are there cement corruption issues with building a monorail? Of course there are, but it's outweighed by the idea that people
It's a vitally important point that when you are in a peacekeeping situation or you're in a critical situation and you're doing emergency economic intervention, it's not the same thing as development. And so there may be a long-term development goals that would lead you in one direction, but if you are trying to stabilize a situation, you might choose something like a monorail in a place that doesn't need it because it has a political consequence and you're trying to make a political point. And I think that's an important distinction. I'm going to go here and then here. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'd like to come back to your question, David, about what is it that could be done now on the economic front. And I think we ought to look at ways in which the Nigerian government has lost resources in the past. And I'm surprised that we haven't yet raised the issue of oil bunkering, because effectively there's ineffective governance, there's corruption, and a number of other economic ills. But one of the ways in which the Nigerian government has lost money in the past, and in huge amounts, has been through oil, because of the oil bunkering in the Niger Delta and in the oil-producing parts of the country. And so with the downturn in oil prices, that could provide an incentive, because while in previous years, the government could look aside because the public treasury was awash with cash, it no longer has that luxury. And if its security services, especially the Navy, could be rendered more professional and more effective, and maybe the fight against oil bunkering would increase the overall resources that Nigeria could gain from oil sales despite the reduction in oil prices.
Okay, good point. Ma'am, you have.
Yes, thank you. I think going back to what
Leanne... Pull the microphone a little closer to you there. Thanks.
Going back to what Princeton and Leanne said, I think the fall in oil prices will, in a sense, make the chickens come home to roost, because it will be a wake-up call in terms of how much Nigeria has been depending on oil revenues. And so much of the conversation that I've heard in Nigeria is people, you know, fighting over the scraps at the table in terms of who's getting the oil revenues. And I also saw that northern leaders were really focusing on diversification. What kind of industry or projects or economic development would be successful in the north? And so I think that question is really key. What is the diversification? And going back to what Leanne said, how can that be supported through various incentives? It's a very key question, and maybe the oil prices will force it.
I do want to sort of put a parenthetical around this. This oil price thing that we're talking about here is a kind of a big deal, not just in Nigeria. It's going to be a big deal in Russia. It's going to be a big deal in Venezuela. It's going to be a big deal in a bunch of countries that depend on the price of oil, but don't have a lot of reserves. When we talk about sort of OPEC countries, they've got a lot of reserves, the core countries that that talk about, for example, the countries in the Gulf. And when they see a lot of U.S. supply coming on stream, they say, well, we can test that. We can endure a couple of years. But for example, yesterday, Vladimir Putin made his State of the Union address in which he talked about his budget. What he didn't say was that the budget is all based on $100 oil. And he hasn't adjusted away from that. And so he's got a budget crisis, you know, right now. Nigeria has a budget crisis right now. And I think that's got a big consequence. Okay, we'll go Chris, and then I'll go down to you. Yes?
Your comment in the beginning about extremism happens quickly, it also can end quickly. And I'm struck by the fact that if we think of the short-term gain, it will be a weak gain. And it seems to me it has to be more long-term. And I think of Sudan. Oil is fool's gold for countries sometimes, because when they have it, they think they are incredibly wealthy. I'm not talking particularly of the Middle East. And they ignore their other strengths. Sudan can be the breadbasket of Africa. And it's beginning to now focus back in that way. So my point is, I think long-term gains are more important than short-term. And the fact that oil has come down, it's going to force governments to re-engage with its people.
Okay. Yes, sir.
I just want to reinforce the point about corruption. The USIP, along with the Clean Foundation and Abuja, did a survey in six northern states, interviewed more than 600 people about why young men joined Boko Haram, and corruption was one of the high factors in pushing people toward joining Boko Haram. So the exposure of corruption and a cleaner government would make a great difference.
You know, an important point associated with that, by the way, is the difficulty of disaggregating these reasons. If you say corruption to one person, that may be the answer. It might be alienation. It might, you know, be interpreted as a social thing. It might be interpreted as they're having a lousy job and somebody having a good job. And these things all connect in the middle someplace. So as we talk about them, we need to sort of walk slowly around them to see what they mean. Yes.
It might be useful to recall what happened in Nigeria the last time there was a major oil drop in price, and that preceded the sudden demise of Sani Abacha and his removal from the government. And so it can have very important effects where there's a great deal of excess in the government budget, and where patron-client relationships within the government become fractured by the lack of money that's circulating. And then this also means that the governors of the various states who are members of an opposition party can begin to switch parties depending on which one they feel is most beneficial to them, and also can increase pressure from the population on the governors to find funds. Usually they will do this by loans to complete projects which they've started but find they don't have the government funds to finish. So that's one possible scenario. Now, on local institutions, I agree with Pauline that this is very important. And in the north, there are several kinds of very local community institutions that can be useful. One is ward development committees. This is a sub-LGA. These committees are actually mandated constitutionally, and they do work on areas like health development and so on. There are also very important church-based or mosque-based institutions that are extremely powerful and can have a great deal of impact on people's decision-making, and they're recognized by local traditional rulers who are very respected in the north. Okay, so these are all possibilities.
Okay, that's very helpful. I've got six people here. We've got 15 minutes, so I'm going to ask everybody to keep it to about a minute or 90 seconds. Kim is first, then Steve. Then.
Yeah, I'll keep it short. I know we're not in the scenario part of this event yet, but I'm going to pretend that I'm already playing the role of the media. And the first thing that comes to my mind when I hear talk about a monorail project, for example, that is meant to give the perception that there is upward movement possible, the first thing that I would do as the media is go find out why that project is being implemented when it's not really needed. I think that the short-term impact is indeed possibly a sense of optimism for the local community, but if it's not needed in the long term, I think it feeds mistrust. And we've seen that too often with big shiny projects around the world implemented by various governments that are meant to give the local population a feel that things are improving, but it doesn't always translate in actual improvement for the local population in the long term. The second point I'd like to make is I feel that so far when we're talking about the economic drivers, we're not talking enough about the role of women and how important it is to empower women as economic drivers to improve the situation for local population. There are so many programs that are available to do so, and I do think that they have a very immediate impact for communities.
Okay, I'm going to go Steve, then Bronwyn, then I'll go to you guys over here.
Great.
And Paul.
I would just ask us to consider for a second who it is specifically we're trying to target when we think about this problem set in the Northeast. You know, I think there are complicated structural and corruption reforms that we should contemplate in the long term. I don't think, though, for the core Boko Haram who are there and the immediate communities who are at risk, who are either at risk for mobilization or recruitment or potentially are providing passive support, that demands a very complicated near-term solution. I would say we should also think about what specific economic tangible measures in the short term for those communities and those who are most at risk for being recruited into Boko Haram would have the greatest effect. And I think part of its perception and part of it's just targeted assistance generally. So, you know, I think it is important to not treat the whole of the Northeast as one problem, but to really think about its constituent aspects and who supports whom when it comes to Boko Haram and the insurgency there.
Okay, Bronwyn. Yes? Did you want to say something? Okay, go on.
Just a point on corruption, and this picks up actually on Steve's point. If we can look back at efforts to combat corruption in Nigeria, you know, there's been a few lessons I think that we can extract. One being having a supposed reformer, somebody like Nuhu Ribadu, take over the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission that really did almost nothing to really get at the root cause of corruption. And it's not enough just to have one leader or even indeed to have international efforts like we had in the UK or here in the US to go after these sort of grand corruption cases. So I would frame it more that we need to do it at much more local of a level, and that's by empowering local civil society organizations and working on rule of law and justice issues at a very local level so that you start going at corruption like your local police officer who doesn't get paid unless he gets the bribes and then, you know, feeds them up the chain. That will be the start of this rebuilding of trust that people who feel that corruption see it being tackled at a very local level, and hopefully this feeling of impunity will be sort of trickled bottom up because it's not coming top down.
Okay, Paul is next, then I'll come back.
Yeah, I want to get very concrete because I've been working on this, is that there is a silver lining with the oil crunch because food imports will be more difficult given the shortage of foreign exchange. There are agricultural potentials in northern Nigeria for supplying southern Nigeria who have much higher incomes with agricultural products, meat, leather products, agricultural food, grains, all of this can be organized by local industrialists in cooperation with states and agencies like the World Bank. It's already happening with Dangote has invested in sugar in Jigawa State and tomato paste by developing contracts with farmers and guaranteeing prices. We need to work with local business people. At the local government level, that point that Pauline and others have made, it's extremely important to revive local government and to cooperate with traditional authorities there to have much more legitimacy than the local governments as they are now. And they can promote this linkage industry. Textiles are really important. There were several hundred thousand in textile workers at one time in before 1986. Cotton is no longer being produced. All of this can be done through reasonable levels of management and planning.
Okay, by the way, one of the things I'd like you to keep in mind as we go through this is as we get into the scenario, we need to take this and apply it, right? We need to say, okay, in this circumstance, if we want to do this thing at the local level, with whom and how? So that we get a little bit more granular and we're not just coming up with prescriptions, we're coming up with plans. Yes, Tofiq.
So in 2013, Nigeria's GDP is $522 billion. When Boko Haram is going on, its rise from 2009, its GDP is $170 billion. So we're talking about a GDP that goes from 170 to 520 billion. So there's definitely not a problem of resources. Now, I think all the solutions are interesting. I've worked a lot in international development. I mean, we're having a conversation in many ways of saying, how do countries' economies grow generally? It's not really about Nigeria, people saying micro-enterprise, et cetera. I'll tell you the truth. I don't think we all have the answers in this room. If we've cracked the nut, we would be, really revolutionizing a number of economies around the world. What I would say is we should look at what indicators we should be tracking to see if progress is being made, whatever the solutions are being put out. And I would say the primary indicator to look at is economic mobility and the ability to increase economic opportunity as individuals. And the very last crisp point I would make, nobody around this room is going to make that happen. We're going to kid ourselves as saying, we're going to go in and do a project in Kano in the center or the northeast and make the change. It's only if the government has very particular leadership and goes and does things. I think a lot of people here have spent time in Nigeria and probably have advanced many of these very particular ideas there, and we have seen the outcome. So I think once we move forward on saying how do we enact some of these policies, I think that's going to become critical.
It is critical, but I, again, one of the things we have to keep in mind is that if we prescribe something for a government that we know the government's not going to do it, it's not going to work.
Exactly.
So, right, but then you need to find a different prescription. Teresa, and then come back to Leanne.
So I've heard everybody talking a lot about development, short-term, long-term, but I've heard no one talk about security. And it's really difficult to do development in an insecure environment and witness just yesterday or the day before yesterday, I've lost track of time, the second attack in a month on a French-owned cement plant up north. So when you don't have basic security, it's going to be pretty hard to develop the economy.
Right. And I don't think I'm giving away too much to let you know that in the economic scenario, one of the moves in this scenario has to do with an attack on a factory. Security does play a component of it. And, I was once involved in this kind of work in the U.S. government, and the saying we had was, you can't build an economic house on a political or security sinkhole. You've got to stabilize the ground in which you're building. Leanne, and then maybe Raymond, you had something to say. We've only got about 5 minutes, so if we get time, we'll come right back to you guys.
I'll be brief. The one point is on corruption, and just to get back to the entire point of the game is to not be, you know, too idealistic about these things. One of the problems with corruption that we've seen in the Jonathan administration is the real concentration of corruption. And it's not that there's an inherent, you know, there are a lot of people who are probably okay with some sort of corruption being present in Nigeria, but it's been the extreme concentration of the corruption within, you know, a few elites. And if we think about how the northern elites used to have a corruption network that looked much more like a patronage network, you know, that actually had its own checks and balances within it. So not looking at corruption today, here and now in the short term as being a, we must get rid of it all, but trying to think about diversified corruption.
New frontiers in corruption will be the goal of our next.
No, I want to just say a few things about employment. We've talked a bit about youth employment, and a lot of the narrative usually correlates youth unemployment in the north with susceptibility to extremist ideology and extremist groups. But we also tend to look at the youth population in the north as one homogeneous group. It is not. You have, just speak very briefly about a small subset that some of you might be familiar with, the Almajris. And the Almajris are young people who are sent to Islamic school. And because of the decline in the north, economic hardship in the Islamic schools have put these guys on the street. The challenge then becomes, we have with the Almajri not just an economic, but a confluence of economic and societal inequality. And so when we talk about targeted employment, it's not just your usual, let's find jobs for them. We have to find jobs and also realign them societally so that they could reintegrate into society and then go back home once their Islamic tutelage is done. Point is it's a lot more complex than just a straight line. We have unemployment, therefore jobs. We have to look at how best to adjust it to the realities in northern Nigeria.
Okay, 2 minutes. Princeton?
Look, on this corruption question, I'm reminded in South Korea at the turnaround in the 1960s, an international economist said, look, it doesn't bother me that the party takes 15% off the top of every project as long as they pick good projects, and they're doing that. And that's why South Korea turned around. Problem in Nigeria is they take 60% off and there's no good projects there. But the question is not...
So what we're saying is we want to diversify corruption and improve the way the corruption works.
Exactly. Yeah. Because frankly, trying to wipe out corruption in general is not the way you want to do it. What you want to do, it seems to me, is create incentives for political leaders to do good projects. And there's going to be some corruption. And how do you do that? Well, there are a variety of ways, just talking from the international point of view, of bringing investment, because you don't need a lot of foreign aid in Nigeria, whether it's Power Africa, Feed the Future, or a variety of other international programs, to those governors or those ministers who are prepared to do good projects. And you don't ask them to be angels, and you don't ask them that they're not taking off 5% for the party. You're saying, is this a good project, and is it going to deliver? And if it delivers, you're going to get reelected. That's the way it seems to me you go about it. We have to remember there's a lot of sophistication in Nigeria. You're not dealing with a society that isn't sophisticated. Lots of very talented people. You want to encourage them in that direction.
Okay, Peter, last word here.
Just briefly, agreed with much of what has been said about the silver lining in the crisis, as Paul has pointed out. But many of these issues that we're talking about, whether it be corruption, institutions, or working with institutions that are legitimate to bring about economic development, agriculture, all those things, require time. And what we haven't talked about is the economic crunch that's coming to marginalized and vulnerable populations now. You know, a couple weeks ago when Malam Fatouri fell to Boko Haram, upwards of 20,000 refugees went over into Niger, a country that certainly can't absorb that many. And so we're talking about people who need economic opportunities and programs now, not even a crop cycle away. And I think those are two things that need to be disaggregated, the medium to even relatively short term and the now aspect.
Okay. This has been extremely useful. It's been extremely useful to do what we set out to do, which is to give you some principles, some guidelines to frame the scenario that we're going to have. But I want to give you another set of principles, and that is that our purpose here in exploring these scenarios is countering, responding to, eliminating where possible, violent extremism. And that doesn't mean our purpose is improving the state of the Nigerian economy, which is something we wish for, or improving the state of Nigerian governance or Nigeria as a whole. What we're trying to figure out is what are the best steps that we can take to deal with the spread of extremism as it stands right now. Can we slow it? Can we stop it? Can we reverse it? Must we choose to just contain it where it is and try to cordon it in? These are practical choices that we have to face, and I think we need to view it in that practical context. That's what we'll try to do in the context of the scenario that will take place. The scenario has little breaks in it, so you can talk among yourselves, but it does last 2 hours and 15 minutes, and that's why, as a humanitarian gesture, we take a 15-minute break before we get to the scenario. Thank you all for getting us off to a good start, and we will begin at 10 o'clock sharp, right back in your seats. Thank you very much.